Listen, on the grounds of the substitutionary sacrifice of Christ, the believer is made right with God. The believer is made right with God. See, righteousness is three things. First, it's a consciousness. Also, it's a nature. And then thirdly, it's a conduct. We have to understand that by nature, we're the righteousness of God. We said this, that a new nature is now in our spirits as a result of the new birth. A new nature is now in our spirits as a result of the new birth. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. So you see, we have the life of God. We have the nature of God. And it's all because of this finished work of redemption. Romans 6:6 tells us that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, rendered ineffective, and henceforth we shall not serve sin. So we have a new nature. If all that God did in redemption was to just forgive us, you know, remit our past, forgive our sins, it'll be a matter of time we will reproduce the same sins or even worse. But you see, he didn't stop at just remitting our past. He gave us a new nature. So we now have the life of God. We now have the nature of God. We can walk in the light of eternal life. Praise God. And we saw from Galatians 5:16, where the Bible says, this I say then, walk in the Spirit. That's talking about in your born again human spirit. Let your recreated spirit dominate you. And it says, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. As believers, we have the flesh, we have the world, and we have the devil to contend with. Those are three different things. You know, you can cast out a devil. You can't cast out the flesh, except you want to cast yourself out of your flesh and run to heaven. You know, we have the flesh to contend with. And as long as we're here on this earth, we will have the flesh to contend with. But the good news is this. We can present our bodies to God. We can mortify the deeds of the flesh. Amen. We can keep our bodies under subjection to our recreated spirits. God won't tell us to do what we can't do. And like I said, a mighty step towards doing that is holding fast our confession that we're a new creature. See, the more you say you're a new creature, the more real it becomes to you. Because our words dominate us. Our words dominate us. Praise God. Well, number four, talking about seven important things about our redemption. The fourth, which I want to get into today, is that righteousness is not only imputed to us, it is actually imparted to us as believers. Righteousness is not only merely imputed to us, but it is actually imparted to us as believers. And let's see. In Romans chapter 3, and in verse 24, Romans 3:24, talking about our redemption, the Bible says, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Now, being justified there, you know, is the word dikaio, which actually means to show or regard as just or innocent. To show, to render, to show as just or innocent. Being justified there also means being made righteous freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. So redemption made righteousness available. One of the greatest things redemption made available is righteousness. Righteousness. To get the full import of this, we might need to start from verse 21. Of Romans 3. The Bible says, but now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. So God is saying here that yes, there's a righteousness that's based on the law, based on works, which is what the Old Testament was all about. It was a limited righteousness. But he's saying there's another righteousness which is independent of the law, There's a righteousness that is without the law, that righteousness, the very righteousness of God, that it actually has been made manifest. And it is witnessed by the law and the prophets. So the law and the prophets talked about it. For instance, the Bible says in Genesis 15:6 that Abraham believed God and it was counted to him for righteousness. That wasn't righteousness based on the law. That wasn't righteousness based on his works. Isaiah 28 says that he that believes on him shall not be put to shame, shall not be confounded. Now, God begins to suggest that there is a righteousness that's coming, and it's independent of works, which was all they had in the Old Testament. Verse 22 says, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. It says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. It now says, being then made righteous freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God had set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of the sins that are past through the forbearance of God. It says to declare, I say, at this time, his righteousness, that he might be righteous and the righteousness of him which believeth in Jesus. In redemption, God showed himself as righteous. God was fair. He was just in his dealings with the devil. He was just in his dealings with Adam. He was just in his dealings with his own word. Our redemption is based on perfectly legal grounds. It wasn't that we messed up and then God just wrote off our mess up. No, that's not what happened. We committed a crime, treason. High treason. Adam committed it. As a result of that, the sin nature came into mankind. And then man began to reproduce sins because his nature was wrong. The wages of sin is death. He deserved punishment. So Jesus, the second person of the Godhead, took upon himself flesh, became a man for us. Now, it was one man that sold us out. So one man could buy us back. Man sinned. Man deserved punishment. And Jesus, as the representative man, he served the sentence. He paid the price. He served it in full. He did. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, for he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. On the cross, Jesus was made sin. He was more than a sin offering. He was made sin. Our sin nature was laid upon his spirit. Not just that. Our sins were laid upon him. Those are two different things. Hebrews 9:26 says he put sin away by the sacrifice of himself. 1 Peter 2:24 says, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sins should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. So our sin nature was laid on him, as well as our sins. He blotted it all out. He paid that price. He served that sentence. Now remember that his deity, we're humanity. 1 hour of deity suffering is worth more than an eternity of humanity suffering. So God looked at man's sin, and then he looked at the commensurate punishment for that sin. Jesus was there 3 days and nights, cut off from the Father, under the dominion of the adversary, held there in hell. He suffered until he paid that price in full. The time finally came when the Father looked from the banisters of heaven and he said, it's enough. He has satisfied the claims of justice. He has met the demands of the law. And at that instance, Jesus was declared righteous. He had been discharged and acquitted because he had served the sentence in full. And from that moment, the devil no longer had a legal right to hold him a captive there. Eternal life was imparted into his spirit, and he was born again out of spiritual death. With the life of God in him, he conquered sin for us. He conquered Satan for us. He put sickness away. He put away poverty. He had become a curse for us. So the blessing now became ours. He arose triumphant over death, over hell, and over the grave. You see, I used to wonder when the Bible says in Romans 10, 9 and 10, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. It says, so with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Why will believing that God raised Jesus from the dead make me righteous? It's simple. Romans 4:25 says he was delivered up on account of our offenses, and he was raised up when we were declared righteous. The fact that Jesus was raised from the dead meant that he had satisfied the broken law of God. He had paid the price in full. He had been discharged and acquitted.